worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you.
Bearing shame and Good morning, church. That was weak. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
And happy Mother's Day. Please stand and sing with us.
Immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome, church. Let's find our places. It is great to be able to be here today on this beautiful Mother's Day. Welcome, each and every one. Special welcome to all of you moms, grandmas, and we are delighted to be able to be here today and to share this special day, and thank you for sharing your day with us. If you'll take your bulletin, please. A few things we want to draw your attention to. First of all, there is an insert We are coming to the end of our current study on what it means to do and to be the church, and we're going to be tearing into the book of James in the New Testament. Boy, oh boy, you talk about practical living. James is going to be awesome, so we'll tackle that in a couple of weeks. There are no Sunday school or evening services today. This is Mother's Day. We want you to spend time with family and enjoy that time together, so plan accordingly. Lots of other things coming up, though, this month, Craft Day and other things that are listed. The notes are there for you with regards to Operation Christmas Child and the items that are being collected this month. And the youth group fundraiser, they're beginning to items are beginning to trickle in. So if you have items you want to donate for that yard sale, you can begin to bring those things, and we will appreciate your help with that. And then another special note at the bottom, the business meeting will be next Sunday during the Sunday school hour, so please plan on that accordingly. Your annual reports are in your mailboxes. If you don't have a mailbox, there's a stack there at the back, and the ushers will make sure that you can get those. So those are our announcements for today. We are delighted once again that we're able to be together on a gorgeous Sunday morning. And fellas, if you will, we will wait upon you as we worship the Lord with our gifts, as He has provided for our needs for this week. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, it is our delight to be able to acknowledge You today, because all that we are, all that we do, is because of Your goodness and Your grace in our lives. Thank You for providing for our needs and allowing us to acknowledge that every good and perfect gift comes from You, and we do so with our giving, thanking You for that privilege. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. For all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of You, I'm in all of You. Where Your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to You, I owe all to You.
Please stand and sing with us again.
Tears and fears. The world by darkness slain. victory. Since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
You may be seated.
All right, kiddos, off you go. Let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, as we gather, we are so grateful that you remind us day by day of your faithfulness. You tell us in your word that your mercies do not fail, your compassions do not fail. They are renewed every morning. And we are thankful for that renewal, for the strength that you give to us, the vitality that we need to be able to live life in such a way that people may see Christ in us, the hope of glory. And as we gather, we are thankful that in praying, we do not pray to an idol made of wood or stone by the hands of man. We pray to the only true God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of all things, that one who exceeds and transcends time, space, and matter, the Father, the Creator, the sustainer of it all. Thank you, Jesus. This morning, in praying one for another, we ask a very special blessing today upon all of the moms that are here. We thank you for the gift of motherhood and the gift of godly mothers, godly grandmothers, godly women of influence in our lives, and ask that today would be a day in which they are made to feel appreciated and loved and revered. Thank you for that privilege. Father, we know that today can be a difficult day. We know that some of us, our moms are not with us any longer, or we have challenging relationships with our moms. And yet, in the midst of all of those heartaches and needs, we know that your grace is our sufficiency, and we thank you for that day by day. Lord, we pray this morning for our world scene, and we think of the nation of Israel. We pray for wisdom for the Prime Minister and for all of those involved in the conflict that continues with terrorism, asking, Lord, that you would show yourself faithful to your people. asking too for a cessation of hostilities, asking for the preservation of innocent life, for the release of hostages. And Father, we pray as well for believers in Ukraine who struggle with ongoing warfare in that land. Give them grace for the moment, we pray. Here at home, we think of the unrest that is pervading our university campuses. And Father, we ask that you will bolster leadership to be able to quell that which is rebellious. We pray for many of our high schools who will be graduating this week and ask that you would encourage hearts and allow these proceedings to move forward in a way that is honoring and encouraging. And Father, we realize that we bring with us those cares and those burdens that weigh us down. We are reminded of your word that tells us to cast our cares upon you, knowing full well that you care for us. And thank you, Father, that when we are able to let go of the burden, that is when you begin to do only what you are able to do, to care for our needs in a way that brings you that much more glory. Encourage us today from the examples of your word, and we will be careful to thank you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Once again, a very special welcome to all of our ladies this morning, particularly those whom God has blessed with the gift of motherhood. Happy Mother's Day to you. We have a little gift out there in the foyer on the table. Make sure you pick up something there. Take it home with you as a little token of our appreciation for you today. When I refer to the word mother this morning, I'm using it in the broadest sense possible. I want to speak to all of our ladies this morning, all the moms, whether it's biological or adoptive or a stepmother or mother-in-law or married or single, or all of those who have been mothers to so many who didn't have mothers of their own necessarily, those of you who have stepped in and taken up the slack to help a struggling mom or someone who just couldn't do it on their own and you came alongside today, want to speak to you. We are certainly mindful of the fact that Mother's Day is not the happiest day for a lot of people. For some individuals, it is a day that is a reminder of the recent loss of a mom. There are some who don't necessarily have the greatest relationship with a mom. Maybe not even speaking to them because of past hurts and conflicts and things that are yet to be resolved. I want you to know that you're not alone if that is you today, and we certainly are praying for you. But as I look about this morning, I get this deep sense of satisfaction because I know that we are in the company of so many mothers who really love and care for their children, for their families. And children, it doesn't matter how old you are, we'll use the term very loosely. You are blessed to have a godly mother like those here this morning. I want us to affirm moms today. You make sure you take the time to do that in one way or another. But for a few moments, I want to highlight and encourage some qualities that are very, very evident in many as I look around this morning. We want to focus our thoughts this morning from Exodus. So if you'll take your Bibles, I'll want us to turn to Exodus chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 6. These are places we're going to be looking. centering our thoughts around the life example of a mother who, when faced with a difficult and threatening situation, took matters into her own hands to save her family. While you're turning there, let me give you the backstory. The patriarch Jacob and his 12 sons by this time are now gone, but their descendants have multiplied greatly. So much so that it frightens the king of Egypt, Pharaoh. He has reasoned with his advisors that if the children of Israel, if the Hebrews continue to have children at the rate that they're going, they're going to eventually outnumber the Egyptians and possibly take over the country. So he devises a scheme, a dastardly scheme, which mandated that the midwives, the Hebrew midwives, those who were responsible to aid in the delivery of babies, their responsibility was that they were to kill all of the male children during the process of childbirth. We are in chapter 1, and I want us to start this morning in verse 15 of Exodus. Then the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, when you serve as midwife to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill him. But if it is a daughter, she shall live. But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the male children live. So the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, why have you done this? And let the male children live. Then the midwives said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous, and they give birth before the midwife comes to them. So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all the people, every son that is born to the Hebrews you shall cast into the Nile, but you shall let every daughter live. The midwives defied the order of the king, did otherwise. As godly moms, first and foremost, you have a responsibility to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. Now, this is not any new revelation. You might say, okay, that's pretty basic. But it is worth rehearsing in your hearing this morning, because to continue on the godly path that many of you have been on for a while, it calls for a certain amount of sensitivity to the leading and the direction of the Holy Spirit. Because as a mother, you are to make the right decisions for your family, for your children. How are you going to do that if you're not directed by the Spirit of God? Solomon reminds us, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, we are to trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not to our own understanding, and in all our ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. Now, look at what's going on here in the text. As a godly mother, as a godly wife, as a godly woman, what are you going to do when your superior, in this case Pharaoh, asks you to do something that you know is wrong, but to not do so may result in the loss of, let's say for our purposes, the loss of that good-paying job that you've been waiting on for so long? To disobey that edict may mean being bypassed for the next promotion on the job. It may mean that smaller pay increase, or maybe even none, or the loss thereof. Many mothers, particularly single moms, are faced with these types of challenges every day in the workplace. Struggling to get ahead, they're given the option to compromise in one form or another with typically an ungodly, unscrupulous employer or supervisor. But here, in this context, we see two women who themselves, as mothers, are refusing to obey the king, not because they're unruly, not because they're disrespectful, not because they're rebels without a cause, but because they feared God. Listen, moms, and dads too, don't think, fellas, that just because we're talking about moms today that we're exempt. Your day's coming, all right? When the government or the church or the boss or your husband, ladies, whomever that individual is, when anyone commands you to do what God has forbidden and forbids you to do what God has commanded, you must choose to follow God, because as the Bible tells us, it is better to please God than to please men. So moms, yes, it does get hard at times. But we have to remain sensitive to the Spirit of God. He is the one who is going to direct you in the right way. Never, never compromise your character or your integrity on the altar of wanting to remain in good graces with somebody else. You stand up for what is right as God defines right and allow Him to get you out of that situation. Why? Because if you fear Him and hold faithful to His promises, He will not fail you. He rewarded these ladies. Did you see that? Verses 20 and 21. They were rewarded. When you stand up for righteousness, God's not going to diminish you for that. He will bless you. He will bless your household. So be sensitive to the leading of the Spirit of God. Again, look at the last verse. Pharaoh commanded the people, "Every son that is born to the Hebrews you shall cast into the Nile, but you shall let every daughter live." Now in chapter 2. Now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him 3 months. And when she could hide him no longer, she took for him a basket made of bulrushes and daubed it with bitumen and pitch. And she put the child in it and placed it among the reeds by the riverbank. Now, we're told that this was a Levite who married a Levite woman. What does that mean? Well, it means first and foremost that they were equally yoked. They were equally yoked. That's so important in marriage, isn't it? That you be of the same mind, that you be of the same faith. Over in chapter 6, we learn a little bit more about this family in detail, at least the names of different ones. The name of the man, we find, was Amram. And the name of the woman was Jochebed. And of course, the baby boy was none other than Moses. Now, both mother and father are from the priestly tribe, and now while the text doesn't say anything about their prayer life specifically, or their church attendance, or their ministry involvement, based on their ancestral association and how this story unfolds, we can certainly fairly conclude with some degree of certainty that these two people had a deep sense of fear and reverence for God. Fear meaning respect, not terror. In fact, it appears that they loved God and that they were willing to do what was good for their family and what would bring honor and glory to God. But as a godly mother, the text gives us a characteristic that is so important if you as moms are going to raise a family that is pleasing to the Lord. I believe it's easy to overlook this quality that is found in verse 2 of our text. Look at it in chapter 2 and verse 2. It says that when she saw he was a fine child. He was a fine child. What does that mean? He was beautiful. He was unusual. Now, He was a beautiful child. There are times as a pastor where you go and a young family has a new baby, and you go to visit in the hospital or after they get home after a while. And I learned early on that you have to be very, very careful in choosing the words that you use. And, you look at some babies, and if you get there too early, they're all wrinkled and pruny and cone-headed, and you look at that and you say, oh my goodness, you can look at some babies and they're just so precious, and they've got their little their little eyes are closed and they're sleeping, their little hands are curled, right? And they get those little baby pictures, say, oh, isn't that adorable? But then there are some where you just can't say, oh my goodness. About the best you can do is say, now that's a baby. That's a safe answer, okay? So if I come and visit you in the hospital and I say, now that's a baby, that doesn't mean anything necessarily, except I'm just stating a fact and I'm being safe, okay? Now that's a baby, right? My goodness, you don't want to be offensive in any way, shape, or form. But here we're told that Moses was a beautiful baby. He really was. Not only does this term imply that he is a beautiful baby, but he is special. There's something about this baby that his godly mother sees, and that brings us to the second point, where that a godly mom is perceptive when it comes to the future of her children. Do you see it there in verse 3? She's perceptive. She saw something that nobody else saw. That's perception. In other words, like many of you here today, Moses' mother was perceptive. She had a deep sense of discernment. She could see beyond the physical. She could see beyond the natural. She had godly intuition. She had godly wisdom. There was great insight. And she was vigilant. She was observant at an early age. She already saw this child as a precious gift from God. Moms, do not dismiss what God is showing you, even when it appears to be far away, way down the road somewhere, someday, and impossible for you to be able to reach out and touch right now. Listen, speak truth over your children. And leave it in the hands of an all-knowing, all-seeing, all-powerful God who has promised to work out all things for our good and for His glory. Somehow Jochebed perceived that this boy, even at 3 months old, was destined for greatness. Now, the text doesn't say it right here, but over in chapter 6, we learn that she already has other children. Moses had an older brother, and later on in the text here, we're going to learn that there's also an older sister. And as a godly mom, you have to see each child as gifted by God for something special. And that is why when Jochebed looked into the eyes of Moses, she saw more than a 3-month-old baby. She saw a deliverer who would one day rise up and bring change and relief to the people of God. She saw it. She saw that. A godly mother sees the potential because she looks for it. So moms, start looking. Start looking. How is your child going to change their world? When you look into the face of your children, what do you see? Do you see greatness? What is it that you are speaking over them? Speak life into them. Tell that little boy from an early age that he's going to become a blessing to the family. Tell him that he's going to be the first one in the family to grace the palace, as Jochebed, no doubt, spoke truth to Moses. He's going to rub shoulders with royalty. He's going to be the first one in the family to write 5 books. He's going to impact the country in a way that no one has done before. God is preparing him to change the political landscape of the country. Yes, even when they act up, even when they are a little bit hard to handle, speak good things into their lives, because the Bible tells us that life and death are in the power of the tongue. You don't believe that? Trash talk your kids for a little while and see how soon and how quickly they plummet. You see, when we're sensitive to the leading of God's Holy Spirit, God gives us the wisdom and the insight, the intuition, the discernment to see what others may never see. I'm speaking to godly moms here today. Continue to be perceptive when it comes to the future of your children, your grandchildren. Leave the results to God. There's a third thing to encourage us right here in our text. And that is, we need to make sure that we take the initiative to ensure that our family survives. Look at verse 3 again. When she could hide him no longer. Now let's face it. By the time a baby gets to be about 3 months old, they have found their voice. They have found their voice. And this is a situation of where little Moses is making some noise, no doubt. Can't you imagine what it must have been like at home? Aaron, stop teasing your brother. You're making him cry. Miriam, try and keep Moses quiet. We don't want the neighbors knowing that we have a baby boy. You know the edict of the Pharaoh. Harder and harder and harder to hide. Doesn't sleep all the time anymore. And now, when she could hide him no longer, she makes the basket, puts him in the basket. And then, verse 4, his sister stood at a distance to know what would be done to him. You have to take the initiative to ensure that your family survives. You start the process. You have to be proactive, meaning you have to make the first move. Don't wait until you're forced to act. Plan for the future. Interestingly enough, as we work our way through the text, the only mention of Amram here, the father, seems to be with getting married and obviously assisting his wife with her pregnancy. We don't hear much about him anymore after that, other than the mention of his name one time over in chapter 6. And the question is, where was he? Well, we want to make sure that we're not too hard on the poor guy. After all, he is a priest. He's in the tribe of Levi. He has a lot to do. He's got to care for the house of God. But look at the text. His sister stands at a distance to know what would be done to him. Verse 5, now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her young women walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her servant woman, and she took it. It appears that Jochebed, this mom, had to do everything. She had to take the initiative to make sure that the family survives. Now, maybe he helped. I pray that he certainly did, because the Bible tells us that to neglect one's own family, fellas, is to be worse than an infidel. But to moms all around this morning, I'm speaking to you. You have the Spirit of God within you. You have that gift of wisdom. You have intuition. You have insight. You have what it takes to make sure that your family not only survives, but thrives. When the safety and the security and the well-being of your family is threatened from outside forces and outside influences, godly moms don't just sit there. They do something. Even if the man, for some reason, is passive or busy or doesn't have time, don't wait for him. That's all right. Tell him what your plans are and then go and do those things, because you have this capacity to make sure that your family survives. It's amazing to watch the phenomenal transformation of a mother who, when her family is threatened, instantaneously morphs into a creature affectionately known as Mother Bear. Right? If you've never come face to face with Mother Bear, God help you if you ever do. Because there is nothing that a mother will not do for their children. And beyond all of those things that we've talked about, God has also given you something else that we men, for the most part, we just don't have. And that is, God has gifted you with creativity. Ladies, you are creative. You can do more with less. You can get far more accomplished in a day than some of us fellows can in a week. Look at the text. How on earth would this mother think of this? Build a small boat, turn her son loose in the river. That must have been terrifying. After all, there are crocodiles in that river. And she must have thought, what if that little boat flips over and he drowns? You know something? Even if that thought crossed her mind, she dismisses it, because in verse 4 it tells us she positioned her daughter on the bank to see what would happen to him. It tells me this. Her level of faith far exceeds the level of her fears. The level of her faith far exceeds the level of her fears. Her faith in God is telling her that failure is not an option, that God will take care of that which she has entrusted to Him. Now, let me show you the power of God in action here. Maybe you saw it, but you didn't catch it. Go back to chapter 1 and verse 22. Pharaoh commanded all the people, every son that is born to the Hebrews you shall cast into the Nile. You shall let every daughter live. Okay, fine. What did Miriam do? Or what did Jochebed do? She did exactly what Pharaoh commanded. Pharaoh said, put the boys in the river. The problem is, he never said how to do that. She was creative. Real creative. Her back is against the wall. She doesn't have a whole lot to work with. But when she gets before God and she petitions God for the situation, when she comes up off her knees, she comes up with some kind of creative and workable plan. All right. Pharaoh says, put the boys in the river. We'll put him in the river. We'll float him in the river. Isn't it just like God? His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. When we do what He commands, we always come out ahead. God blesses our obedience. So watch what happens. She makes this boat, this little ark, this little basket, and that becomes the vehicle that preserves His life. And ironically, it happens right in the middle of the place that is supposed to end His life. Right there in the Nile. How is it that this chamber of death, the river, now becomes the place of change for the deliverer Himself? And that's not all. The other ironic twist here is that the very ones who ordered His death are now the very ones who are responsible for His deliverance. The would-be killer now becomes the primary caretaker. Listen, if God be for you, He will spread a table right in the presence of your enemies. That's the God that we serve. And to every godly mom here this morning, don't be afraid to take the initiative and make sure that your family survives. God will see you through. But there is a fourth and a final thing that we want to say to encourage you today, right out of the text, and that is to be supportive of those who want to lend a helping hand. Again, verse 5 of chapter 2. Now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river with her young women walking beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her servant women, and she took it, and when she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby was crying. Now, doesn't show it right there in your English text, but the Hebrew word means he was screaming. Man, he was cutting loose. So she took pity on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." And the girl went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed him, and when the child grew older, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son, and she named him Moses, because, she said, "I drew him out of the water." Try to be cooperative with those who want to help with the rearing of your children or your child. It's a unique situation, but sometimes in the case of single moms, or when there's a separation, or where there's a divorce involved, a mother or a father becomes so angry that they'll do everything that they can to keep a child from one another, only to the detriment of the child. We have to be adults. We have to be big people. We have to be the parents. We have to be supportive. And if a child lives with a godly stepmother, don't reject that. Because two godly mothers may just be a little bit better than one. Circumstances being what they are, we make the best out of things. And in some cases, you may not have a child all day or all week, but whatever time you do have with those children, you make it count by being godly and by pouring into those children so that your hand of influence can still be written all over that child's life. Godly mothers don't allow the spirit of anger and resentment to keep them from making wise and godly decisions for the well-being of their children. And Moses' mother supported her son, in this case, by being in a position to help out whenever his adoptive mom needed some help right here at the very beginning. Now, in today's world, various situations may be different, but the principles remain the same. The child that you brought into the world may not be always physically living with you, but still find ways to be supportive and cooperative with others who may have those children so that you still have a godly heritage, a godly influence that can still be felt and retained by those children. Because the truth of the matter is, sometimes it is God who orchestrates our circumstances in His overall plan to protect us long before we're able to even see it. Think about it. In the broad scope of Exodus, the rest of the Israelites became slaves, but not Moses. Instead of being a slave, Moses received a quality education and training, something that his own parents wouldn't have been able to give him. God positions him for what He is preparing him to do. So we even have to cooperate with God so that His plan, His purpose is going to be manifested in our lives and in the lives of our children. We have to be supportive of our kids, even when they are not always, all the time, under your roof. And learn how to cooperate with those whom God has placed in their lives to help us rear them in a way that is pleasing to the Lord. Whether it is the church or whether it's grandparents, so many others, people, institutions that God has placed in our lives to help us raise our kids, we want to embrace that help. Four thoughts this morning with regards to a godly mom. She is one who will be content to be sensitive to the leading of the Spirit, perceptive when it comes to the future, taking initiative to ensure safety and security, and being supportive of those who would come alongside. Father, as we bring our time to a close this morning, we thank You for this example. We thank You for Jochebed's faith in You in the midst of a time of great turmoil and testing. Thank You for this righteous woman and her family, and for the wisdom that we see even in those early, early years. Father, we admit to You that parenting is not for cowards. We find ourselves, Lord, in a day and age, in the period of human history, where it is a fearful thing many times to raise children or to think of raising children. And yet, You continue to bless, You continue to provide with those successive generations as part of Your overall plan. And in doing so, You have given to parents the awesome responsibility and the high and holy privilege of raising children. Thank You for godly examples. Thank You for the examples that You have provided for us through Your Word and through the lives of others to inspire us, to encourage us, to lift us up, to give us a focus and a hope in this process that seems to pass oh so quickly. Father, bless our moms today. May they see the great privilege of their responsibility, and may they be appreciated. Encourage us, dear Father, in light of living life in a world where raising children is often frowned upon, looked down upon. But yet, Father, may we see the future through the eyes of a child. Thank You for Your truth. Allow us this week to be the salt and the light that the world needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand for our closing song.
Your burden weighing heavy, is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all its dealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen. Who can wipe away the tears, the broken dreams and wasted years, until the past to disappear? Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. The wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 Who will take my cross to Calvary? Pay the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way. He rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 and let my Jesus change your life.
You are dismissed.